when it comes to extraterrestrial contact, and especially elaborating on having such a long-term relationship, mm-hmm. Do you still have contact?
I do, but not as much as I did. It was extremely profound during the 90s, but there's personal reasons for that I don't want to go into. I've been told that when it will resume, you know, we've kind of come to an agreement. However, I have almost what I call a permanent uplink. When I need to know something, it's there.
There's the phenomena of ghosts that you mentioned.
We have to first talk about the human being before I can explain the ghost part. And what I've been taught, what I've learned is that the human being, as we are now, is something that we're not used to thinking of ourselves as, and that is we are really an integrated existence. And so we're not just one being, as you think of yourself as John and who you are. We're actually a coordinated aspect of energies, intelligences, merging with a biological unit, the body. And when we die, the biological unit is no longer able to carry a particular frequency of awareness. In some circumstances, a fragment of that energy will still remain active and still hang around the frequency of the Earth's domain and function somewhat independently. But it has a very limited understanding when it does that of who it is and where it is. And usually when you can get to it, and you can get it to understand itself, to heal certain aspects, it will move on to where it needs to be. So usually, for the most part, we talk about a ghost per se, as we regard it in the everyday lexicon. It's usually an energy essence, an aspect of the person that truly doesn't understand what has happened to them or where they're at or unwilling to move on. And usually they're very much focused in just their personality and not in higher knowledge. Once they become a little bit more receptive to understanding their circumstances, usually another type of, I call them energy essences, but or intelligence or being or spirit, will come in and gently help guide them to where they need to go. Usually when this happens, it's almost like a drama or scenario is set up to make them feel comfortable and they're integrated into accepting and understanding that other energy that's come in to help them over time. Does that make sense to you as I start to explain?
No, absolutely. It's the coolest explanation I've ever had for a ghost. There's a, no, really, it's the most logical. And again, to go back to what I was saying earlier, these are the little bits of information that fill in the void we need to know about. It's amazing.
Yeah, life is like a buffet, not a sit-down dinner right now when it comes to information. It should be all put out there so people can figure out what works best for them.
You also said earlier that you understand the non-human mind.
Mm-hmm.
What's that about?
Well, here's where people get so caught up in the mythology of extraterrestrial reality. And I'm going to take it down the extraterrestrial path first, or maybe even just stay there. You know, humans tend to interpret the world thinking with their human cognitive abilities and assume that everything else is like that. But it's not. My experiences with extraterrestrial reality have brought me down great understanding of the differences between meeting different species, and I tend to make a distinction between two different classifications of beings. One are the what I call the biologicals, beings that you'll find who will have a biological body like the human, and there are those who do not. They are just pure energy essences. They no longer need to be seen or used or have any relationship with a biological body. And they are much more advanced than we are. But experiencing all within the biologicals, you know, those that are human-like, those that are nothing like human, those that are, you know, like bipeds like we are and have, you know, morphic shapes such as a human does, and those that look nothing like it. Then, you know, the multidimensionals and learning all from them, it amuses me so much when I read something in the typical media and they talk about, well, we've discovered these other worlds. You know, the scientists have seen these other worlds that can support life. And I think, but you're thinking life in terms of human. You know, you have to think of life more in terms of energy and frequency and electricity than human. And, you know, they say, back to my comment, you know, well, we have these other five worlds that we feel now can support life if we can find more about them. And I just think, roll my eyes and go, you know, this is what holds the human back, is thinking like a human. In the years earlier when I used to speak out, I came out in 1999 to talk about extraterrestrial reality and my experiences with it. And there are times when, I remember I was speaking, I was invited into one college, a psychology class. And a gentleman said, they would never do that. And I'm thinking, how would you know? How presumptuous of you to determine how an entire life form or individual being would or should or didn't, should, you know, wouldn't do something. So, you know, we have to stop with the limitations and think openly. And we also have to understand not just humanity and intellect and cognition, but self-awareness and intelligence in new terms. In doing so, it's going to prepare us better to understand beyond the human mind and how it thinks. And as an aside, from when I talk about beyond the human mind, I find there's a lot of wisdom in how things are looked at, because humans tend to get focused up on minutia in the moment at hand, where extraterrestrials, many of them that I've encountered, have more of a continuity in terms of focus on a strategic viewpoint or overview. And there's a more of an ability to take in multiple factors or streams of information and bring it forward. Another detail about extraterrestrial reality is that my experience has been the majority of them don't use languaging processes such as we use. You know, we tend to speak to each other and use sentences and paragraphs. Most of them tend to use holographic imaging when they're communicating with you, which is much faster than the languaging process. The holographic imaging is you suddenly become aware in your mind of an image, and instantly, you have so much knowledge attached with that. You know, today we can use the term, it's like a computer download, but it's much faster. You know, it's as if you had an entire 26-volume encyclopedia unfold upon you with this one image. And so it's much faster. That particular aspect of the non-human mind and understanding is how actually most of the animal world works, too. And that's what helped me to understand it and be able to accept the knowledge that I had and what I could see and understand about the animals, is that they can communicate, animals can communicate within three ways, but the primary way is images. And they send images to you, and the images are associated with feelings and thoughts.
What are soul lessons?
Well, soul lessons are the term that I use when I refer to the major reasons why we've incarnated. What I found is that generally, during our lives, most of us are here to learn something. Now, there's two tracks with that. One are the personal self-development lessons, and these are usually the ones we've been working on for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. You know, it can take us 18 incarnations to learn how to not be selfish, or some people 1,800, you know. So the soul lessons are things about how to be a better person, and they may have to do with some very fundamental, simple concepts, as I just said, is how not to be a selfish person, how to learn to be a more giving person, or dealing with aspects of emotion or, you know, simple experiences. Those are the things that oftentimes we have yet to perfect ourselves with, because when we do master these, we become wiser, kinder people. There's a secondary pathway that many of the people I work with are on, but not all, and that is the greater soul lessons in terms of service, where you've finished a lot of your self-development through the incarnational pathway. And now, because of you've done that, you have opportunities available to you where your focus is more in service to humanity and those around you. So there's actually two levels that I see and that I work with within the soul path, this personal self-development and the ones where you're serving greater humanity. And in my work, it's sometimes an interesting journey because there's two people that I generally work with, those who are very aware, very self-aware, have highly developed abilities